real facts about me and my life, and realizing that that was just thoughts, that that was just beliefs. And a little thing that says live has just come on my screen, which leads me to believe that this would be a good time to pause and restart.
That's right. So I'm going to swap places with the amazing Judy Tang, who thought of all this out, and I'll catch you when you're here.
Right on. Looking forward to it, James.
Sorry about the technical difficulties, but we are live, so welcome to Brain. We had a few technical difficulties, but it was all sorted, so we're really lucky to have Jamie Smart with us today for half an hour Q&A. As you all probably know, Jamie is an internationally renowned writer, speaker and coach. You might have seen him appear on Sky TV and BBC and also in publications such as the Daily Telegraph. So we're very, very lucky to have you with us for the next 30 minutes or so. So thank you again, Jamie, for joining us. So today, I think Jamie's going to share with us his knowledge on how to use our innate ability to reach decisions more quickly, clearly, and effectively. So we're looking forward to that. How are you feeling, Jamie? Thank you.
I'm feeling great. How are you guys doing?
Yeah, we're doing pretty good. So we're all ready to go and rumble. If you're happy for us to shoot off some questions.
Yeah, ready to rock. Go for it.
We kind of collated earlier from a few people. So One of the things that we're interested about is what gets in the way of good decision making.
Well, that's such a great question. So there's a short answer and a long answer. And the short answer is superstitious thinking. Now, what do I mean by superstitious thinking? That the reason that people get caught up in finding it difficult to make decisions, or that sort of thing, is because of a fundamental misunderstanding about where our experience is coming from. So to just give you a metaphor for this, my youngest daughter, Tallulah, she's 11, and she, for years, has wanted to ride roller coasters, but she wouldn't go to the theme park until she was tall enough to go on the adult roller coasters. And so she hit the right height about 2 months ago. And so a few weeks ago, I took her to a place called Alton Towers for her first go on roller coasters. So the first roller coaster we get to, we're standing in the queue, and it's about a 20-minute wait to get on the roller coaster. So we're lining up. And she's really going through it. She's like, one minute she's excited and looking forward to it, the next minute she's feeling freaked out, she's thinking about bailing out, she's all over the shop. So we get to the front of the queue finally. We get our seat on the roller coaster, and she loves it. It's absolutely amazing. So we get to the end of the ride, we get off the roller coaster, and she's like totally filled up with, she's like, that was incredible, that was amazing, I loved it so much. Then she says something really, really telling. She goes, I was really, really scared when we were in the lineup, but I wasn't scared at all on the roller coaster. I felt great on the roller coaster, but I was scared in the lineup. I said, well, what do you make of that, Tallulah? And she thought about it, and she goes, well, I guess I was feeling my thinking when I was in the lineup, but I thought I was feeling the roller coaster. And that, I said to her, nice one, that's exactly what was going on. And I said to her, you'll see people doing this all over the place. Metaphorically, they're in the lineup having a feeling, and what they're feeling is their moment-to-moment thinking. But they believe that they're feeling the roller coaster. They believe that they're feeling the job interview next week, or what their boss said to them last week, or what would happen if they quit their job and did something they love. They see, and this is a fundamental trick of the mind. We're moment to moment, we're living in the feeling of what I'm going to be calling the principle of thought taking form. Now, here's what I mean by this. Like, you guys are there in Australia. I'm here in London, England. I'm being pinned to my chair by gravity. The universal gravitational force is holding me to my seat. And as I look at you guys in the room over there, the universal gravitational force is, your gravitational field is holding you guys to your chairs as well, which is good. It'd be kind of hard to talk to you if you were floating around the room all over the place. But it's the same universal gravitational force that's holding us to our chairs. It's a principle. And that principle, and I will bring this round to decision making, I promise. That principle works on all of us in exactly the same way. It doesn't care anything about what color our hair is, or how old we are, or how nice we are. If I went up to the top of my building and dropped a war criminal off it, they would be plummeted to the ground by the gravitational force. But it would work the same for a Nobel Prize winner. Gravity doesn't care at all because it's impersonal. It's a principle. Well, I'm using the principle of thought in the same way. The principle of thought, a field, if you like, a gravitational field of thought, is creating our experience moment to moment. So it's giving us a picture of life. And it's working the same way for everyone on the planet. Everyone has this power of thought that they're born with. You used the word innate when you introduced me. It's an innate capacity that we all have to think something and then experience it as a reality. And so we have feelings, and our feelings are always telling us about the principle of thought taking form. There's a one-to-one match between feeling and thinking. But thought is slippery. It looks to us. So when Tallulah was in the queue for the roller coaster, she was 100% of her feeling was telling her about the principle of thought taking form in that moment. It was telling her about the reality that thought was creating for her. But it looked to her like she was feeling the roller coaster. Well, that was a misunderstanding. It doesn't work that way. You can't feel a roller coaster you're not riding on. Doesn't work that way. But it looks like it works that way. That misunderstanding is what gets in the way of good decision making. I bet, like, if I asked everyone in this room, what are some of the best decisions you've made? My guess is the best decisions they've made haven't been when they're on the horns of a dilemma trying to figure it out, going, oh, part of me this, part of me that, blah, blah, blah. The best decisions have come when they've fallen out of that and suddenly known what to do. Like, oh, you know what? It's like a head smacker. I know, it's obvious. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that. Or, you know, you're struggling trying to make a decision, and then you sleep on it. You wake up the next morning. It's like, oh, I know exactly what I need to do. And it comes to you. Well, it comes to you typically when you're not up in your head trying to figure it out. Now, I'm not saying, you know, so make sure you don't do good due diligence. No, obviously, you know, if it makes sense to do due diligence on something, then do your due diligence. But when it comes to making the decision, the best decisions come when we're not caught up in a superstition about where our experience is coming from. Now, I don't know if that makes any sense at all to you, Judy, so I thought I'd better check in.
That was pretty awesome. Thank you for that. Wow, it's good. Well, that leads on to the next one, which is a bit of a comparison. So how does an effective and a clear decision then appear as compared to, say, the ineffective and an unclear decision?
Well, I think everyone has their own experience of that. You know the difference between making a decision from a place of stress and anxiety and freaked out and all that sort of thing, between making a decision that sits right with you, that just has the, like, I'll give you an example. 18 years ago, no, not that long ago, 16 years ago, I went on a 2-day NLP course, had some insights, and 2 weeks later I quit my job. Now, before I quit my job, so I was working for a consultancy, doing program management and that sort of thing. Before I quit my job, I lined up a contract so I could work doing the same kind of work but get more pay and have more time flexibility and that sort of thing. Now, until I went on that weekend training course, I'd had all kinds of beliefs about how my friends could do that kind of thing, but I couldn't. And I didn't really know about the mind or anything. I just thought I was different from them, and that's why they could do it and I couldn't. And this insight I had is like, oh, you can do whatever you want. you can do anything you put your mind to, and you know, some of it'll work out and some of it won't, but there's nothing different about you that means you can't create a life that you enjoy and that you love and that sort of thing. So I just knew, that quitting my job and taking a contract was the right thing to do. Now, lots of my friends said, Jamie, you're crazy. That's, you know, you got a good secure job and that sort of thing. And on paper, it didn't necessarily look that logical, but I just knew it was the right thing to do. A few years later, I was running Salad and my old NLP business. Everything was going great. I was doing a bunch of corporate consulting. And I suddenly knew that it was time to leave the world of corporate consulting and do stuff more focused at individuals. Now, it didn't look good on paper. On paper, I was making a ton of money from corporate consulting, but it felt like the right thing to do. So I had my way of knowing that that was coming from my own internal navigation. And you each have your examples of this. You know, you have examples of when you knew that something was right for you, but you didn't do it, and you regretted it. You've had examples of when you did something, even though everyone was saying you were crazy, and it worked out great. We've all got examples of that kind of what I'd call an inner knowing. Some people call it gut feeling. Some people call it intuition. Some people call it wisdom. What I'm suggesting is that the thing that gets in the way of us seeing that is getting caught up in the outside in superstition, getting caught up in our misunderstanding of where our experience is coming from.
Okay. So it sounds like a lot of people get, I'm sure it sounds like I would get caught up in a lot of those things as well.
I do too.
Yeah, and I guess that sort of ties in quite nicely with, you know, you talking about decluttering the mind and accessing clarity. Is that, would you say that's correct? Decluttering the mind. So, you know, instead of getting caught up with superstitions and so forth.
Well, yeah, here's what I find is that, from an NLP perspective, we talk about people having their map of the world or their model of the world. So people don't experience the world directly, they experience their model of the world, their map of the world. And there's a great quote from Gregory Bateson who said, I'll paraphrase it, he said, the biggest problems in the world are caused by the gap between how nature works and the way people think. And if you look at the history of the evolution of human knowledge, you can look at that evolution as a process of us closing the gap between how nature already works and how we think it works. So, like, we used to think that the sun went round the earth, because that's how it looks, right? That's how it looks in Australia, too. It looks like the sun comes up over there and goes down over there. But that's an optical illusion. The earth's actually going around the sun, but that's non-obvious. Like, really smart people like Aristotle and Socrates didn't know that the earth went around the sun. And they were very brainy. But they didn't know it, because it sure looks like the sun goes around the earth. That's how it looks. That's how it seems to us. That people used to think that stars and planets were held up in the sky because they were floating on crystal spheres, or they were made of like tinsel or something that was very light, and they were made of something different than stuff on Earth, and that's why they floated up in the sky. But that it was always gravity. It was always gravity that had the stars, and it still is that has them hanging up there in the sky. People used to think that the earth was flat. They used to think that illness and disease was caused by bad smells, but it didn't work that way. It's just a misunderstanding. And so the history of, you can imagine that there was a ton of stuff that used to be on people's minds that isn't on their minds anymore. Like sailors, they used to be very worried about sailing off the edge of the earth. But you'd be hard-pressed to find a sailor today who's worried about sailing off the edge of the earth. So understanding how life already works takes things off your mind in that regard. Well, what I'm suggesting is that people have a fundamental misunderstanding of where their experience is coming from. Like Tallulah did in that queue. They think that the future can be giving them a feeling in the present, for instance. Well, that's not possible. It's absolutely, I know it looks like that, but it's not possible. And as you start to see that for yourself, it takes a lot off your mind. So this isn't an application. It's like, okay, how do I apply clarity? You're born with innate clarity. It's already in there. You'll have a natural capacity for clarity, for peace, for well-being. You have a natural capacity for good decision-making, for leadership, for connecting with other people. You have a natural capacity for joy and love and happiness and resilience and presence. It's already in there. Like you were born with your sense organs, your eyes, your ears, your sense of smell and taste and touch, but you were also born with the innate ability to use them. You didn't have to go to how to smell stuff classes. You're born with the innate ability to smell stuff. And you're born with an innate capacity for clarity and peace. And the only thing that gets in the way of that is a fundamental misunderstanding of where our experience is coming from. And it's been learned, that misunderstanding. So it's, on the one hand, it's a trick of the mind. So you'll see little kids get really upset about stuff. But you notice how fast little kids get over it? They just get over it. Like one minute it's the end of the world, and the next minute it's like, oh, pizza. They get over stuff really, really fast, faster typically than their parents do, because little kids haven't yet joined the dots and built a model for, okay, these are the things that I need to feel bad about. They haven't built out the illogic of the outside-in misunderstanding as thoroughly as their parents have. So they still get tricked by it, but they get over it fast. So here's what I find declutters people's minds, is getting a more profound understanding about where our experience is coming from, a more embodied understanding about where our experience is coming from. And as you see that more clearly for yourself, it literally takes things off your mind. So I find people saying, wow, since I learned this, I have so much more time. Because they're not spending their time going over stuff in their heads over and over again. You'll start experiencing deeper connections with other people and with yourself and with life. I heard the previous speaker talking about the people who quote-unquote live in their heads. Well, that's being caught up in their models and running around in an intellectual experience of life because of this misunderstanding of thinking that we're feeling something other than this principle of thought taking form moment to moment. So as you see through this misunderstanding for yourself, it'll just take stuff off your mind. It clears your mind and you get more reconnected to your mind's automatic self-clearing capacity.
Okay. I know sometimes I get a bit neurotic, so I'm just probably speaking for a few neurotic people out there when they do have the question in terms of when it comes to decluttering and accessing that innate clarity and so forth. I mean, how can you tell? How can you tell the difference between decluttering your mind and just perhaps not thinking through enough or, you know, not taking all the details that you need? Sometimes, sort of, I know for myself, I tend to worry whether if I actually let everything go and take it from there, am I just letting too much go or, you know, not really grasping things enough when I should be?
Well, I'm really glad you asked that question. And that kind of speaks to my point. There is no rule for how much due diligence you should or shouldn't do. There is no rule for what's the right amount of detail to go into or not to go into. There's no rule for how much should you think something through or not. It's all case by case by case by case. And so there's power in understanding. See, So if you take that example, I sometimes worry that I'm not looking going through things in enough detail. Well, the feeling of worry isn't telling you about how much detail you have or haven't gone into. The feeling of worry is telling you that you've got worried thinking in that moment. But if you believe the feeling of worry is telling you about your, you know, the work you have or haven't done or what's going to happen next or whatever, that misunderstanding is going to mess with you. So I'll give you an analogy for this. Everyone can join in on this one, actually. When you're in a car, what does the speedometer measure?
Speed.
Bingo. Correct answer. Second question. What does the fuel gauge, the petrol gauge, measure?
The amount of fuel you have left in the tank of your car.
Perfect. So the speedometer is an expert on how fast you're going, and the fuel gauge is an expert on how much fuel you've got. But the speedometer doesn't know anything about how much fuel you've got in the tank. And the petrol gauge doesn't know anything about how fast you're going. They're a feedback mechanism for one thing. The speedo is an expert on speed and ignorant of everything else. Well, your feelings are an expert on the shape that the principle of thought is taking form in your thinking moment to moment. So your feeling is wedded to your moment-to-moment thinking. Your feeling is telling you about your moment-to-moment thinking, but it doesn't know about anything else. It doesn't know about the future. It doesn't know about what kind of person you are. It doesn't know about your upbringing. It doesn't know about it. It knows about one thing. It knows about the thought-generated reality that's being created in the moment. You're always living in the feeling of the principle of thought taking form. But thought's a slippery fish. It's a trickster. It'll tell you that you're feeling other things. It'll say, oh, no, this feeling, it's not just telling you about your thinking in this moment. It's also telling you about your job prospects. Or it's telling you about your bank balance. Or it's telling you about how much due diligence you've done. That's not how it works. That's a trick of the mind. And I know this is going to what I'm saying sounds simplistic, but it isn't simplistic. It's just simple.
Okay. So for people that have, I mean, this is really interesting stuff. For people who have found that clarity for themselves, I mean, can you give us some example of how it's manifested in people that, you know, who have done them for, have achieved that for themselves? I mean,
sure.
Are they sort of you? Feedback and experiences and so forth?
Yeah, all kinds of things. So, funnily enough, I had a client the other day, and he, very successful businessman, but feeling kind of stuck in a number of areas of his life. So I worked with him, I did an intensive with him, and we worked on this, and early in our session together, he goes, Jamie, I need a simple formula. I need you to lay it out formulaically for me. Can you lay it out? So I said, okay, but we'll call him Bob. I said, here's the formula. Bob plus a misunderstanding equals stuck. Bob minus a misunderstanding equals clarity, freedom, joy, that sort of thing. So when he first came in, he was quite heavy, quite intense, struggling, stuck, all that sort of stuff. By the end of our time together, he described himself as feeling like he did when he was a teenager again, like for the first time in 20 years. And having a lightness and a fun about it. All of a sudden, all the problems he'd been seeing in his business were opportunities for him to come up with solutions and make a difference and that sort of thing. He's feeling very optimistic and positive, and it's persisted to this day. So what you find as people start to see this is they kind of have a change of heart. A lot of heavy thinking drops away. They get more connected with themselves and with life and with other people, and you see results. So I have one client. She's a coach, and she had been she'd invested literally tens of thousands of dollars in coaching and training and that sort of thing, and wasn't getting any return on investment. So much so, she decided at the beginning of last year she wasn't going to spend another penny on training and coaching. And then she read my book, and something in it spoke to her, and she knew it was the right thing to do. So she hires me, and she books on one of my programs. Within 3 months, She'd gone from not being able to get people on her training courses to filling up training courses. She did a TED talk. She moved to Bali, which is where she'd always wanted to live. She got pregnant, which she'd been, you know, trying to do for ages. It's, now, I'm not saying that'll happen to everyone. Guys, you're not going to get pregnant. it's not a generalized thing, but what I find is that if I was to put it in very simple terms, you know, we've all had the experience of we've got a friend and they're trying to do something, but they're really struggling, and you go, you know, they're just getting in their own way. They just need to get out of their own way. Well, I'd say that the areas of life where we do well are the areas where we're not getting in our own way. And the areas where we struggle and buy 50 books from Amazon and are seeking for, tell me the method, tell me the solution, give me the answer, those are the areas where we're getting in our own way. And so, in a way, the thing I see again and again as people see this for themselves, get this understanding for yourself, is you get out of your own way, and then what's been trying to come through you starts coming through. So people start going, oh, okay, they start taking steps in their business that they've been putting off, or they start picking up the phone and making those calls to potential clients, or they just stop stressing about stuff, or they start being themselves because they're getting out of their own way. So really, it's kind of a formula for getting out of your own way and living the life you're here to live.
Okay. Well, I think we've got one last question, but thank you so much for all of that.
Yeah.
Now, we all know that you're based in London, but we're pretty lucky that we've got you coming down to Australia in October for NLP Superfest from the 3rd to 5th of October in Melbourne. And I know you'll be speaking with us and sharing with us your knowledge on effortless influence. So could you just give us a bit of a teaser about what we could expect if we come to NLP Superfest?
Yeah, well, certainly when I'm... It turns out that the stuff I'm talking about here, the principles behind clarity, they really, really play out when it comes to influence, persuasion, communication, and leadership. It's very, very powerful. Like, if you've ever had the experience of, like, you can feel that someone wants you to do something and they're trying to push you to do it, you can feel them needing you to do it, that's not effortless influence. That's very effortful non-influence. What I find with clarity, and this is true whether it's influence in the context of sales or marketing or general communication or leadership or coaching or training, it's all about influence. It's all about having an impact on another person and guiding them in a direction. So I have a kind of a shorthand for this, a model for this, which I call the Callings model. And part of it, the C stands for connection, which is about a sense of connection. So where does connection come from? And how can you get a sense of connection with the person you're talking to or the group you're talking to? So the C is for connection. The A is for alignment, and it's about being aligned with your sense of purpose and with your own integrity and authenticity. The first L is for leadership. You know, influence, as much as anything, is about stepping up and leading. And so each of these things are, you know, they're an initial for a different piece, but really they're all just emergent qualities of the same thing, which is the real important bit, which is what I would call insightful understanding. Here's the interesting thing. When I was running my old NLP business, I sold at the end of 2012, but when I was running that business, I had it structured so I hardly had to do any sales. Everything was done through marketing. Everything was done remotely because I felt kind of uncomfortable about having sales conversations with people. Sales is kind of the pointed end of influence. So I felt kind of uncomfortable with that. Felt fine about influencing people in the context of a training or a coaching session, but when it came to sales, I felt a little uncomfortable, so I'd been avoiding it. And as I started to see the principles behind clarity and the inside-out nature of life, and as I started to feel more connected with people, I actually changed my business model, so I do way more selling now. I look for opportunities to have sales conversations with people because it's so cool and we get so connected, and it's such a great opportunity to deeply serve them. And so for me, it's a completely different context for influence than I had always had. I'd always had the kind of used car salesman context for influence, and this is a way of influencing that so resonates with people who are doing heart-centered work and purpose-aligned work and that sort of thing, because it turns out the very things that make someone interested in how the mind works and impacting other people and being a good communicator and that sort of thing, those very qualities are gold dust when it comes to being influential, just as long as you're not using the old sort of pressure tactics models of influence. So it's a way of influencing that feels great, that's congruent and impactful, and that works. So that's what I'm going to be talking about when we're talking about effortless influence.
I can't wait. I'm really, really looking forward to it. And for anyone else who's going to be in Melbourne from October 3 to 5, Jamie Smart's going to be with us for NLP Superfest. You can find us more about us at nlpsuperfest.com. But Jamie, you're also doing a two-day masterclass workshop with us the weekend after. So everyone, just check out our website. You won't regret coming down to see Jamie and doing all this kind of really awesome stuff. So thank you again, Jamie. I really, really appreciate it.
And my pleasure. Thanks for inviting me.
Catch you in the next couple of weeks then.
Looking forward to seeing you. Bye.
Awesome. Thanks for joining, Brain Lab.